Hello, Illuminated Souls. I'm Brianne Drioni.
And I'm Tina Damore. Welcome to Shamans After Dark. Today, we'll welcome our guest, Chrissy Ogilvie. She'll be sharing her inspiring story of working through a severe illness and how she became the heroine in her own journey. Welcome, Chrissy. We're so excited to have you on.
Thank you. I'm really glad to be here. I'm looking forward to this.
Yeah, really glad you're here. So we'll start out by just saying that Chrissy and I go back to middle school in central Massachusetts. I remember going to high school with her and being in The Wizard of Oz. And I've worked together with you in helping one of your dogs that has epilepsy. I worked and did some shamanic work on him. That was a few years ago. But I haven't actually seen you in so long. So it's right now we're videoing and I can see her. And it's just really good to see her. So we go back a long way. So you went through a huge time in your life, was challenging. And so we just want to know like what you did beforehand. How was your life before all of this happened?
All right. Well, I grew up in Sterling, Massachusetts. You know, our big claim to fame is the home of Mary Sawyer of Mary Had a Little Lamb.
That's right. But
studied in my undergraduate. I was actually an early childhood and communication disorders major. And so, and then I did 2 years of that. And then I was doing, then I switched to elementary education and reading. Literature. But then I started working at Perkins School in Lancaster. And it was funny because I thought I was going to work at school, be an aide type thing. And the first day of training, they say, this afternoon we'll have SOLVE training. And so I was like, hey, what's going on? And SOLVE is Strategies of Limiting Violent Episodes.
Oh, gee. Okay.
Yeah. I looked at the trainer. I said, I think I'm in the wrong training. And so, but that led me to working in special education. I got my bachelor's in special education from Fitchburg State, also my master's there. And of course I knew everything after getting my master's. So I took a position in Newburyport, Massachusetts. And it was a group of 9 students with all different diagnoses, grades 5, 6, 7, 8. And I was told to contain them.
Oh,
yeah. And I did it for a couple months. It was crazy. I was teaching reading, language, math, science, social studies for 4 grades and still trying to accommodate needs. But anyway, I went to the principal and said, hey, I want to start including them. He was a smart man. If they didn't make it in my class, they would be... their next step would be going into some kind of a residential type situation. And so it was awesome, but I knew nothing about autism. And I had 4 students right off that had autism. I didn't know anything. And I definitely didn't know about autism and inclusion. And so, but that was the first class was art that we went to be included in.
Nice.
And we showed up at the door with my nine kiddos, and she comes out of the classroom, closes her door, and she says, you have to take them. I can't teach them. And so, yeah. And like I said, I had my master's degree, so I knew everything, or I thought I knew everything. And I was like, no, you know, they're going to stay. And I'll tell you what, I'll stay with you. I'll manage behavior. Mm-hmm. You do the art part. I can't be a stick figure. And so I won't tell you it was sunshine and roses, because it wasn't. There were growing pains. There were ins and outs. But by the end of the year, she was telling everybody how amazing my program was. And
that's amazing.
To get these kids in their classrooms. And that made me really excited. And so I always said I was going to be a doctor one day. I think I meant a veterinarian, but I decided my family went to Florida, to Disney in November of 2004. And I was wearing shorts in November. I thought, this is great. So, and that had nothing to do with me deciding to actually look for doc programs, but I started to look, and I looked in Florida. And I was accepted to University of Florida and went down, met with the professors and all of that. And end of the day, it was this amazing man, Dr. Terry Scott, looks at me and he says, you don't belong here. You shouldn't come here. And of course, I've been accepted. I'm down here looking for apartments. And you tell me that? He said, no. He said, you're not a researcher. He said, you are a teacher's teacher. And he's right. The stars aligned or something happened. I don't know, but I got home from Florida, and the week after, there was Dr. Lisa Deeker from University of Central Florida was in Worcester, Worcester, Mass, doing training And so I had contacted UCF. That's how I found out she was going to be here. And so she said, why don't you come down and we can talk, but you're going to have to do it in and out of me doing the training. I said, all right, that's, you know, that's good. I'll go. And really wasn't sure at that point about public speaking. Wasn't always my strong point, but I go down there and I meet her and she's great. She's just incredible energy. And you can tell that how much she's involved in doing this work. And then she says to me, okay, go down to this room. You're going to lead a breakout session in this certain room. I was like, wait, I don't exactly know what you want me to do. And standing in a group in front of a group of 25 to 30 people, when you don't know it, I was like, it was like sink or swim. And apparently I swam. So I was accepted into the program. I graduated in 2008 with my doctorate with the focus on autism. My dissertation was very long titled, the impact of video modeling and peer mentoring on social skills of middle school students in inclusive settings.
Wow. That's really cool.
Yeah. So basically we created these video models of different social skills, short little videos. And then we had the students with autism watch the videos with their peers, and then they practiced with their peers. And then I went into the classes that they were included to see how things were working out. We had some results. I mean, it wasn't stellar or groundbreaking or anything, but it was a lot of fun. Although one of the guys that helped me video, he said, you know, in the movies, people get paid extra for working with children. And I said, well, you're not getting paid anything, so I'll double. I'll be that generous with you. But it was pretty cool. I went into higher ed. I started at Southeastern Louisiana University in Hammond, Louisiana.
So you left Florida?
I did briefly. I thought that Louisiana was where I was going to end up. And wonderful colleagues, got to do a lot of work, had some concerns. And coming from the north to the south is a big difference.
Yeah.
Big, not good, bad, or indifferent, just different.
It's very different. I understand that one.
And there was still, they still hit their kids in schools.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow.
I'm at a loss for the
what year was this?
This was 2010.
That's crazy.
Wow.
And it still exists in Florida. And I went into a school to do an observation, and there, I was done with the observation and I came out, was talking to the teacher in the office, and a man came in, and as he walked in, he was taking his belt off his pants. And I thought, well, this is kind of strange. So he came in and I said, well, what's going on here, to the teacher? She said, oh, somebody must have broken a rule or is in trouble or has a disciplinary action or something. And I said, what does that mean? And she said, well, they, at the beginning of the year, they have three, they sign off on this. Parents sign off on this. They have three options. The dean or vice principal, I think that you could call them deans there, could paddle their child. The parent could come in and do it, or the child could be suspended.
And, that's crazy.
Yeah, I went home that night and called my advisor, Dr. Deeker, called her and said, hey, listen, you got to get me out of here now. I don't care what it is. I will go anywhere. I can't. You know, part of my job is going to be going into the schools. I can't see that. I can't even think about it.
I taught in North Carolina and I didn't see anything like that, but it is true. It's a different world.
It certainly is.
But I never saw anything like that, Chrissy. Wow.
Yeah, that was hard. I mean, and again, things kind of stepped into place or moved into place right at that time. The University of West Florida, which is in Pensacola, was hiring. Just right at the same time. And so I went, I was chosen for the position. I spent 3 years there, I think. And it took me that long to realize that I'm really not meant for higher education. I want to teach.
Yeah.
I that's what I want to do. I went into higher education so I could teach teachers how to work with kids with autism in inclusive settings. Like I had started in Newburyport. That was, I wanted to do that. I wanted to see that. It didn't have to be autism, but that just happened to be my focus because they make sense to me. They're my tribe. I tell people all the time, they're my tribe. I get them. And, but so higher ed just wasn't my thing. Mm-hmm. And so I went into this position that I worked at was Florida State University Center for Autism and Related Disabilities, FSU CARD.
Okay.
And it combined everything that I loved. I was working directly with, worked with middle school, high school, and adults. So middle school, high school, and adults with autism, their parents, their families, the schools, the community, first responders, just, it combined everything. I was doing trainings, which
from
someone who wasn't too fond of public speaking to go and, you know, I mean, my biggest presentation, I was a guest speaker. There was over 1,000 people there.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. I was mad at the publisher that invited me to do that.
Yeah. Well, you know, it goes to show you when you're passionate about what you're talking about, you kind of forget about who's listening, you know?
Yeah. Once I get started, I'm fine. Yeah. But he said, it's going to be a good size crowd, really? You know?
Good size. Oh my God.
Yeah. That was fun. They asked me to tell my story about my teaching and how I ended up where I was and what their books had meant to me in my classroom. But that was cool. But I left higher ed, started working with FSU Card, and just had just so much fun. These social groups with my adults, which just cracked me up. And I collaborated with the National Flight Academy that's in Pensacola, Florida. And we designed as a team programs. They have camps there where any kiddo can sign up in grades 6 to 12. And they go for a week, and they are walking on board an aircraft carrier, and it has all of the sounds. It looks exactly like one inside, everything, the lighting, and they are put into teams and or squadrons, and they had to learn all this military speak, which, you know, it worked. I still don't get some things. I just say them because it sounds official. And but the kids spend that week, they come in, they have a flight partner, and they have to plan missions. And I'm talking about like deep STEM work going on here with measurements and altitude and jet fuel and how much is it going to, if you go this way, how much you're going to use. And then they were given at the end, they were all of the squadrons, each different group of squadrons was given a mission. And it could be like a rescue mission, and they're using flight simulators throughout all this. So during their mission, their flight partners were up in the control room, and they were down actually in the aircraft and had to fly the mission. And it was amazing seeing it come together. So we took all that and adapted it behaviorally, mostly some academically, but to my clients with autism. And throughout the time, so they would go, they had the 6-day experience, which was, they were just fully included. Those are my kiddos that had a lot more, and then we had 1-day experiences for my folks that needed a little bit more support. My folks with less verbal skills, my folks with some questionable behaviors. And then that was cool for a year. And then we switched it up and we added a 3-day, which was awesome. It was just so cool. I had 24 students my first time we did it with autism, grades 6 to 12. And we spent Friday afternoon, Saturday, and Sunday in the aircraft, on the aircraft carrier. And you've never experienced life if you haven't spent that long of a time with that many people with autism in that kind of tense situation. Like, it was awesome.
How did it enrich their experience? Like, I mean, what was the response that these students had?
It was life-changing for some of them. For some of them, it was the first time they'd ever been away from home without a parent or relative. Some of them were like, wow. Some of them decided to start their focus, our high school students, where they wanted to pursue more STEM-related activities and education and become a pilot or become a mechanic or just really, you know, and for some, it was just the social part of it where they were hanging out and we had peer mentors, some, not a lot, but just to have an opportunity to just hang out with other kids, yeah, because it might not always happen for them because of social things.
Right, right. That sounds amazing. Wow. Yeah,
it sounds like it was super impactful for everyone involved. I mean, that's an amazing program to put together. Yeah.
Yeah, it was cool. I wasn't good at the simulators. I was convinced they were moving. And the guy that was in it with me, he's like, Chrissy, it's not moving. I'm like, don't, what it is. So that was one of the cool things that I got to do. You know, I worked with the Satori Foundation, develop a sailing program for kids with, and families with autism, where we would take them out in the bay for a day. They could steer the boat if they chose, but they all had to help as far as raising the sails, maintaining the lines. They all learned about that, but it was also just fun and it was just going over the waves a lot. So got to do that, which was really neat. And some of the kids we took, one girl that we took sailing, she ended up going on, changing her focus and wanted to become a marine biologist because.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. She was a neat kid. And of course, the first time we were going, I'm not going on that boat. You can't make me go on that boat. I said, you're going on that boat because your mother's gone and I have to be on the boat. She got me to the point where I was like, you know what? I'm not making deals. This safety, we gotta do this. I can't leave you here on the pier.
That's so amazing, Chrissy.
I loved my job. Absolutely loved what I did.
It sounds like it was super fulfilling and that you just had so much going on and we're impacting so many people's lives. And that's just what a gift to be able to give to the community and where you were teaching and all those people that you've gave these amazing experiences to. I can imagine how rewarding that must have been for you to be in that space of creating these programming and seeing these kids thrive and have these experiences and just the shifts in their lives that came from that. It must have been so exciting.
Yeah, it really was. It was kind of selfish on my part too, because it made me feel so good doing what I did. And fortunately, it was good stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, like, you know, when you're doing what you're supposed to do, it's supposed to make you feel good though. So it's like a win-win for everybody.
Yeah. You were answering your calling.
Yeah.
And then Chrissy, I know we want to talk a little bit about, you know, you had all of this going on and all of the success and all of these amazing things that were happening for you. And then everything changed June 22nd in 2020.
Yeah. And that, you know, that might be the understatement of the the century, but I don't know how to describe it other than that. It was, things were going along all right. They, you know, loving my job, doing what I was doing. And, you know, I had planted a lemon tree in my backyard, which apparently is a lime tree.
Oh, okay.
It was labeled lemon, but it produces limes. I was feeling good. I had lost a lot of weight. So I was more active. I was feeling more, my self-esteem was good. And then there wasn't any big, you know, I wasn't in an accident. There wasn't any big crash. I didn't fall. There was nothing there. And then there literally was nothing there. I got up to go to the bathroom and went down. Somehow managed, wedged in between the toilet and the tub, and had lost control of my bowel and my bladder, and I couldn't feel my hands.
So you couldn't feel your legs or your hands, and you lost control. Wow,
that had to be really scary.
Yeah, I was terrified, and I didn't really know what to do. And I've never used Siri in my lifetime ever. And my phone was in my bedroom, which wasn't too far, and I'm yelling, Siri, you know, call Laura, call Dan. Those are two of my friends, that we were very, very close. And they fortunately, I mean, this was almost midnight that this was going on, and they came over, and Dan used to be an EMT, and they got me cleaned up. I mean, we crossed some friendship boundaries there as far as what they saw. But it, you know, really, you know, they really wasn't the time. But they called an ambulance, and that it had turned over to midnight, so around January 23rd. And as I was leaving, I don't know if I was in disbelief. I think I definitely was in denial. But I remember as the stretcher was taking me out, I was looking back, and we had put the dogs out in the backyard, so they weren't, you know, too upset and in the way, and they were both sitting at the door.
Yeah,
looking in, which is something that they did when they wanted to come in. But I just, like, it was just, that's burned in my head, that image of them sitting there. And so then it was, you know, I got in the hospital. The first night that I was there, they gave me some kind of medicine that was supposed to calm me down. And because I was pretty out of my mind, what's going on, and trying to call family, and they're trying to intake me. And well, I don't remember what the medicine was, but it made me hallucinate. And I've never hallucinated in my life. And they were all different ones. The biggest one that I thought that I had somehow created, I had murdered a third grader.
Oh, wow.
When she was riding her tricycle in Clinton, Massachusetts. None of this is true. None of this is any way. Let me state that. But yes. And then someone had read a book, and this was like 300 years ago, that I had actually done it, even though the year was the same year that we were in, was 2020. And so how I had gotten that, but then they had found out about it. And so they were, and I knew they found out about it. So I was trying to get the attention of the police. I wanted to be arrested for what I did. And then there was this whole parade, and sitting in a gymnasium, and my nephews are sitting there crying, why did you do this? And everybody I knew, and terrifying, just weirdness.
Yeah. And
I was begging my friend, who was a lieutenant, and I think he might have been captain at the time, but yelling for him. And the whole time this is happening, I don't know why I remember it. I'm told it's weird that I remember it.
Right. I was just going to say, like, usually hallucinations, you only, remember bits and pieces of them. How long was the hallucination taking place? Was it like half an hour?
No, it was over an hour.
Oh my God.
And there were, but I could tell that one lasted a long, long, long time. It went on and on.
Did they take you off that medicine?
Oh yeah. Pretty quick. Okay, good. Pretty quick. And they had called my mom and my sister, and because they were trying to give me medicine to calm me down from the medicine that's supposed to calm me down. But I wouldn't take it.
Uh-huh.
And I can remember hearing, because I thought they were fooling me. I thought that my mom and sister really couldn't be on the phone.
Wow.
Right then. And I just, no, I'm not taking it. And then the reality, towards the end of it, reality starts to set in, and they somehow got the meds into me, thankfully. But
right.
Yeah, that was the first night.
Well, it's the last thing you needed at that point, right? You're already dealing with, why are your legs not working? Why can't I feel my hands? Why did I lose control of my bladder and bowels? Like, and so how long were you at this hospital?
I was there for 2.5 weeks. And then they discharged me to what was considered an acute therapy rehabilitation center. It was like a hospital. And I won't, I try to keep as many names out as possible.
Sure.
It was not a good experience at all. I spent the majority of time in bed. The occupational therapist would come up to work with me. Of course, I can't hold anything. And that's just, I'm still not sure what was going on. Oh, in the 2.5 weeks I was at the first hospital, there were 5 different diagnoses.
Oh, wow. Sure.
For what I had. And then they sent me at the next facility. There were more. And then it was awful. I cried all the time at the second facility. I was just out of my mind. I had lost everything. And that's what just it. And it was like being smacked in the face every time I would think about it. I'd think about my house. Well, my friends, this was afterwards, we had gone through all my stuff. And they were selling it or packing it up or giving it away. Oh, and that's just a property, that's not the emotional and the mental and the physical part of it. But it was, every little thing was
out of your control.
Yes. And it was this, I couldn't be angry at anyone or anything. I couldn't blame a drunk driver. I couldn't, there was nothing I could be angry at. And I think that was part of what was hardest. When things were terrible in Florida, my family decided that I needed to come up to Massachusetts. Great doctors.
What was the straw that broke the camel's back in Florida that made you decide to leave the state and go to Massachusetts with your family?
I don't know that there was any one thing. I think it was my family saying, no, we're done with this. I could not make decisions. I didn't have, I never had like a memory loss, although sometimes I wonder, like, cause I can't remember things that I know I used to remember, which is, I don't know if that makes sense.
Yes, it makes sense.
But I don't think it was, I don't think it was one thing. It was, I just think that, I mean, I was not suicidal, but I wanted to die.
And Chrissy, did they have any diagnosis for you at this point in time, or they still had, they were unsure about what was going on for you and they didn't have answers?
Yeah, they still weren't sure. They had started doing some tests. They looked at Guillain-Barré, which it presents similar to, but ruled that out. And it was a succession of testing, and then they would say it's this. Oh no, it didn't. And but my family finally decided, you know, all right, this is enough. You know, all she's doing is breaking down more and more. And so it was called Angel Wings, I think, or Angel, it has Angel in it, transport, but it's a Learjet. They flew me up. It was so funny. I had these two huge retired Marines who were medics that were flying, and they came to the rehab that I was at, put me on the stretcher, brought me over, loaded me up. And I'm thinking, how are you going to fit in the plane? It was a stretcher on one side and a seat on the other. Wow. A little place up back. But it was, for as bad as it was, the reason that I was doing it and reason I was there, it was pretty cool flying in their jet. And they had me strapped to the stretcher. And so I'm leaning over the side because I couldn't really move anything. But I wanted to see, and I could look right through the windshield. I could see the pilot and the co-pilot. One time the co-pilot was reading, and I thought, I don't want to see that. I know there's autopilot, but I get up here, and I got to the Brigham through different connections and people knowing each other. We were able to get me connected with one of the top neurologists in the United States.
At Brigham and Women's, you're saying?
Yeah, at Brigham and Women's. And just that got to, they immediately, I feel like I, it was like a bloodletting every time someone walked into the room. It was someone was wanting to stick a needle in me or a tube or something. And with this same question, of course. And of course, it was COVID.
Oh, geez, that's right. Yeah.
So family couldn't come down. No one, and when I was in Florida, no one could come down to be with me.
That's awful. And then your memory is so sort of spotty too. So trying to think back on all of that and give them the right information.
Oh, and I'm sure every time they asked me a question, I gave them a different answer, not on purpose, but it was just things were all over the place.
And were this still, you still having the same symptoms, Chrissy, of not being able to feel your legs or your hands and, so you were just really at the mercy of those around you then.
Yes, I was dependent on anybody and everybody. And I'm a fiercely independent person.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to do I like my independence and I have that strength inside me to do that. And then all of a sudden it was gone. I couldn't feed myself. Somebody had to feed me. Somebody had to change out the briefs that I had to wear and wash my body. And when I got out of bed, two people helped me into the wheelchair. And
yep.
It was nuts. Finally, when I got to the Brigham, I was able to see family once in a while.
That's good. That's good.
They were really good to me at Brigham.
Now you were there for 6 months.
No, I was there at the Brigham. The whole hospital rehab experience was 6 months.
Okay.
And so I was at the Brigham. It must have been almost a month.
Okay.
That I was there. A little bit, probably less than that, because I was 3 months exactly at Spalding, which is Spalding Rehab in Charlestown, which they had sent me to. And still didn't have a real diagnosis. By that time, they were starting to call it chronic inflammatory demyelinating polyneuropathy.
And at what point, I know that in your story, you said that there was a neurologist that came into your room, looked at you, and said something like, this is as good as it gets. Was that in Massachusetts or Florida?
It was in Massachusetts. It was at Spalding, but it was my neurologist that said it. So not someone from Spalding. And we had gone, they did this experimental drug with me, it's rituximab, which is an experimental cancer drug. And so its main thing is it depresses your autoimmune system because they do really feel strongly that this is an autoimmune disorder. That's what they know. And so I was doing that. I can remember my mom was there and he came in and my mom said, what's the prognosis? What do you see? And he did not say exactly, this is as good as it gets, but those were his words. And that definitely was how I heard it and how my mother heard it. And what do you do at that point? I didn't know what to do.
Yeah. So I'm sure you were grappling with all of these emotions. Did you feel like at that point you hit rock bottom, or had you already felt like you hit rock bottom before that?
I had already hit rock bottom. I had hit rock bottom when I was in the first rehab, because I was just giving up. There was nothing. When they came and, you know, do you want us to wash you? Do you want us to do this? Nope.
Yeah. You were just getting depressed.
Yeah.
And like, yeah, totally understandable. So how did that all like impact you emotionally? Like, you just, did you view the world like, I don't want to be there anymore. I don't want to be here. This is horrible. I'm never going to get my life back.
All of that. I didn't, like I had said, I was not suicidal, but I wanted to die.
Yeah. Yeah.
I could not envision for the rest of my life staying in a hospital bed, people feeding me, people washing me. I could not. And at that point, I had done no kind of walking or even sitting up. People were helping me do that. And so it was, I thought, no, I can't do this. I can't do this for the rest of my life. I can't be this person here, because I'm not a person. I'm a shell. I went through the five stages of grieving about once every hour. I never got to acceptance. And never, I still haven't. And I have a counselor, because it's really impossible to navigate this without somebody. And he says, I call it the A word. He says, you know, we're moving towards acceptance. No, I'm not. You know, there's still too much anger and upset there.
Yeah, just be where you are. I mean, so what was it within you that decided, no, I'm going to walk again?
This is going to sound weird, because when I've told people, when I've said it to people before, they're like, no, that's not what it is. I kind of know. But I was bored, and not in the sense of traditional boredom, but I just was like, you know what? I don't want to do this. It wasn't any like big momentous, I'm going to rise to this challenge. And mm-hmm. It wasn't that at all. It was just like, you know what? I want to try doing this. I'm done with being where I am and doing what I'm doing. I mean, unfortunately it worked out.
So it sounds like to me, in some ways, you're like, yeah, I accept this. This is the scenario, but that's not for me. Like, because I sort of went through a similar thing when I was sitting in a wheelchair one day. I was like, okay, so I could do this for the rest of my life. And there was something in me like, nope, I'm not. So was it sort of the same thing with you, or was it a little bit different? Or
it was a little bit different. There was never like a moment where I was like, all right, this is going to change. It was just like, all right, I wish I could describe it better, but I was like, no, I'm done. You know, uh-huh. I'm done with having people feed me. That had happened at Spalding. The aide had come in and she's cutting up my food, because that still was something I couldn't do. I could barely hold the fork. And she's like, well, do you want me to feed you? And I was like, no. I'm just going to do it. I'm tired of you doing this. I'm going to do it. Well, there was food all over the room, you know, because I tried to pick it up in my, you know, my hands that I couldn't feel the fork in, even with the adaptive device, you know, and it's flinging all over the place. You know, she comes back in. I was just determined to, I didn't want to do it. I didn't want to, I think probably the biggest thing was I didn't want to be dependent on people.
Yeah.
The thought of that forever terrified me. And I was like, no, I can't. I won't do it. But it wasn't any, I really never felt a moment of inner strength driving me. And I wish, you know, I mean, this would be a much more, you know, empowering story if I felt those things. But it was just a matter of like, no.
It's still super empowering. Like, there might not have been a moment, and it could take you years later, you know, looking back going, huh, you know, because looking back at things is always easier than when you're still sort of in it.
True story.
Right. So yeah, give yourself a break.
I mean, if you look at how far you've come.
Yeah.
Like, do you think at some point you did kind of step into your power again, because you were so disempowered and so dependent on others? And then you're like, I'm not doing this. Like, I'm just, what did you, right? What did you have to lose at that point other than to try and say, I'm not doing this way anymore. And this isn't working for me. I need to be busy. I have things to do, and kind of really stepping into that. Cause you had this whole journey of changing that. Yeah, reality, in a sense.
You didn't care if the food was all over you. You were going to do it no matter what. It doesn't matter. That's super inspiring. That was like your first little baby step there. You know, that's what I see. I think this story is super inspiring.
It's been crazy. It's just in thinking about the different things that you don't realize that you do until you can't do them anymore.
Uh-huh. Yep.
Yeah, you know, and trying to learning that, you know, to teach myself and to learn from the incredible, incredible therapists, physical therapists, you know, occupational, everything that I was so fortunate to. It's hard to get into Spalding because it is such a great facility.
Yeah.
And, you know, but somehow through managed to get in there and just, it was, you know, everything, a lot, you know, not everything, but a lot of what I can do now is because of what they had me doing there. And my physical therapist that I quickly learned when she says, and I think, and Tina, you might know this too. When your physical therapist says, do you want to do?
Oh no, you don't argue. You're like, I suppose.
It's not an actual question. I remember looking at her saying, why do you ask me if you know right? Why do you do that?
But you know, you had these integral people in your life. And I'm wondering here, you know, what was the moment when you finally stood up out of that wheelchair and took your first steps?
Yeah.
Like what was that like for you?
It was emotional. It was the first night I got to Spalding. And they were doing, despite the fact that I'd been like all over the place and had things stuck all over me and that, and they transferred me over there and the ambulance, I was there for like maybe an hour, still like no idea what was going on, looking around everything. You know, had my own room, which was nice, beautiful view, which I took in after the fact that night. I didn't know what was going on. Well, the physical therapist, Jillian, came in and she's like, all right. And she's doing her, you know, hold up your hand. I'm going to try to press down, try to resist it and all that, which I couldn't do anything. It just went right down. And then she's like, okay, we're going to stand up. And I just was like, you shake your head. And I thought, oh, I'm screwed. This one wanted me to stand up right now. And I stood up with it. I mean, she was holding me up for all intents and purposes, but it was the first time that that had happened. And it was, you know, and it started the ball rolling. I mean, for one thing, it doesn't matter how you feel. You're getting out of bed for physical therapy and occupational therapy and for getting, you know, you're getting yourself, getting, helping people to get you cleaned up now that you're doing it. It was never an option not to. So I think that was part of it. I don't know that I ever took anything as a challenge to do, but I do have this compulsive need to please people. And to be helpful. I was voted most helpful in our eighth grade class. Have the yearbook to prove it.
I think, have that around someplace. So yeah, now I do.
I think that was, but that was kind of my thing where I, you know, I was a pleasing person. So I didn't like to say no to people. Mm-hmm, and mm-hmm. You just didn't say no to Jillian. I mean, I wanted to do that because I don't know that I really don't know that I'm competitive at all. I know I've said that before, but I like to be recognized for doing really good things. Mm-hmm. That's why sure. I loved my work for that. But I think some of that snuck in there that I needed to meet some kind of goal so then I could move on to the next goal. And I don't know that I wanted applause for doing it, but I definitely, that was something to drive me to keep going.
And so like, when you started walking on your own, was it sort of like still the ball was rolling and you're like, what's next? What's the next goal?
Yes. I had certain rules that they put in place for me, which is stupid because they know I'm not going to listen to them. You know, like if I had bought parallel bars before I left Spalding. So I had parallel bars when I came home and it was, you know, and I had a walker and I had the wheelchair but the rule was, you know, I wasn't supposed to transfer out of bed into the wheelchair on my own.
Okay.
And that didn't last too long because I was just, you know, I wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm not laying in bed here and not that, you know, but, and then the rule was, okay, you can't walk with the walker over to the parallel bars. Well, that, you know, that didn't last. And I just, it was excessive rule break that really got me going. And it was, there was just one thing I do one thing, be like, all right, hey, all right, got this, moving on to the next. I mean, and it's, I don't want it to imply at all that it wasn't an absolute hell going through it, because it definitely was. You know, if I didn't look at my feet, I didn't know where they were. So I spent a lot of time with my head down, you know, holding on to the walker with hands that couldn't feel it. You know, it was scary. And it was, I can remember my family put up, there's a slight step up into the kitchen, maybe 3 inches. But definitely not wheelchair accessible. And when I was using the walker, when I was starting to get better with that, you know, we'd walk from my bedroom throughout the house down to the other side of the house to my mother's bedroom with the walker and with breaks, you know, sitting down and that. And it was, we were coming back down one of the first times and there's this little ramp. I did find getting up it. You know, I charged up it like a moose. But going down it, I can remember standing at the top of it. Same situation with the walker, same support, physical therapist in front. I had a personal care assistant, my PCA in back of me. You know, my mom had the wheelchair. It was a train we had going on. And I froze at the top of the ramp. I mean, and this was not a tall, steep ramp. I could not move.
But I mean, I understand. If you go down and you can't stop, you're you know, butt over tea kettle, and it's dangerous because you don't feel your limbs. So yeah, I understand.
Yeah. I ended up saying, I want the wheelchair and going down in the wheelchair. It took a long time for me to be able to match that. Everything took, and I'm a very patient person, but when it comes to myself and my own progress, I'm very impatient.
Yeah.
And so I just wanted things to keep going and keep going. And I think part of me thought once in a while, I'm going to prove you wrong, Mr. Neurologist. And I feel pretty much like I have, which is nice.
Victorious.
Yeah, it's a nice, it's like, I feel very happy. I don't know if proud is the actual feeling, but it's almost like like sticking my tongue out, you know, neener, neener, neener.
I did it
now, huh? I'm not going to walk. You know, I'm going to be dependent on someone for the rest of my life.
Yeah. I went through something. I mean, I remember this first physical therapist, I couldn't really do much of anything. I tried. And he said at the end, you truly are disabled. And there's something in me that was like, watch me. Are you walking, you know, you're walking with a cane now? How are you doing now?
No, I am fully independent in my walking. I was never someone who liked physical pursuits or working out. I mean, I was over 400 pounds at one point during my life. And I never, physical stuff just wasn't, you know, wasn't what I was good at or wanted to be good at. And and now I go to the gym 5 days a week.
Wow. Good for you.
I switched between walking and riding the recumbent bike and going in the pool. And I can do 4 miles at a time walking, which before my legs are like my knees pop. My legs do not hurt when I walk, and I still have to look at my feet sometimes to make sure I know where I'm going.
Yeah.
But my legs don't, you know, when you work out and all that and you can feel the muscles. Yeah. I can't feel that. My legs start to feel stiff or almost like there's a balloon inside that's being filled up with some kind of thick gel but I enjoy it. On the bike, I've done, the longest I've done is 11 miles at one time. At one sitting. Yeah, never. If anyone ever said, you're going to go to the gym 5 days a week one day.
You're like, nah, what are you telling me? So you still sort of don't feel your legs still, but you can sort of talk with your body and know when you're ready to stop because of the pressure. That's good.
When I walk on regular roads, like outside when I'm not on the track, I have to pay more attention to my feet because my foot will scuffle sometimes. And if I'm on an even pavement, I've gone down a couple times, but you know, you get back up, which is an experience all of its own. I can't feel if I kneel, I can't feel my knees on a surface. It feels like they're on a gel pillow that's kind of moving around. The same when I sit. It's very strange. It's, you know, my fingers feel like, ever go to a manicure and get a manicure and they put your fingers in that wax stuff, the paraffin?
Yeah, paraffin, yeah, yeah.
I feel like all the time that's what I have on my fingers.
And so with the diagnosis you were given, is that still the same diagnosis or has it changed? And you don't have to share if you don't feel comfortable.
Oh, no, I'm totally okay with it. They still call it CIDP, but
okay.
He's not so sure now because of the progress that I made, the nerves must not be getting demyelinated.
Right.
But he doesn't know. And that's the weirdest thing. I've been like, I've constantly been like, you were one of the best, well-known, well-researched neurologists in the United States. And you're telling me you don't know. And you're telling me you don't know if this is going to happen again. You know, and how do you not know? How can it? And I guess I can't remember what the numbers are. I want to say like one in 100,000 people who have similar, and all of us are different, mm-hmm. but similar presentations to other autoimmune diseases, but no one in 100,000 might present the same way as I do. And they don't know.
They can't also pinpoint when, you know, why it came on the way it did at the point of your life. They probably can't even tell you that, can they?
No idea. No idea. They did so many tests to rule out every possible thing, but they keep coming up with, well, we don't know. And it's very lonely.
Yeah.
To be there. I can remember saying to him, there must be somebody else somewhere that this is happening to, even if it's not exact,
mm-hmm.
but that I can talk to about this. And, and he said, no. Yeah, not through here. And I just thought, like, how? You know, how this? It can't be something that was made for me.
Yeah. I mean, you know, at the same time, I keep getting this vision of you, like, whatever it is, you kind of broken the mold of it. You know, with whatever is inside of you that's decided to not listen to your doctor saying you're going to be, this is as good as it gets. You're like, nope, I'm not doing this the rest of my life. You know, that's to me right there, very inspiring. So, I mean, you know, we never know what's going to happen to us in our lives. That's one thing I had to really accept mm-hmm. during my illness. And so I sort of went through this phase of, okay, so if it comes back, it comes back. But right now is what I can drink up in my life.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's, you know, that I absolutely am right on.
Yeah.
With what you're saying.
Yeah. Good. I'm glad that resonates for you.
Yes.
And Christy, now that you're, you know, gained back this level of independence and have made such a marked progress in your recovery, you know, what are your plans for the future going forward? What are your hopes, dreams?
I want to get back to Pensacola. I won't, my former position is not available. And I had applied for it when they had it, but they decided to go in a different direction, which I don't know what the direction was. I know, you know, the toddler part of me wants to throw myself down on the floor and have a tantrum. That was a common recurrence in my thoughts throughout this whole process, was that I just wanted to throw myself down and bang my fists and stomp my feet and yell. But my hope is to get back there. I have my PhD in special education, and I would love to get an online remote teaching position with one university. I'm adjuncting for a bunch of different ones now, but do that and be able to move back to Pensacola, teach remotely online. And then I want to start up my social skills groups.
Nice.
And I mean, I would charge for them because there's a lot of work that goes into it. Materials.
Sure.
It wouldn't be crazy, but
yep.
to start up those groups, you know, to because there's not, Pensacola has a great autism community, but there aren't a lot of autism services.
Oh, that's too bad.
And who I worked for, FSU Card, is one of the sources of support for the community, and they do a lot of great things there. But there's no one currently that has been doing the middle school, high school, and adult social skills groups. And that is, you know, that's like playtime for me. I used to be a swim instructor and a lifeguard, and I was in charge of waterfronts. I used to laugh because they're paying me to play in the water with these kids. I felt like a big joke on them. So I would love that. Really just to I tell everybody, I just want to go home. I want my life back. And I think some of that's unrealistic and thinking, because it's not.
I mean, I remember having to really sit with myself and going, okay, that part of myself doesn't exist anymore. So I have to grieve that and let it go, and then start focusing on what I actually want in the future and what's possible. Mm-hmm. I understand that piece a lot. But I really, you know, if you put your mind to it, Chrissy, you can get down there again. You know, from Massachusetts to Florida again, you can do it.
I'm determined. I love my family. I love being here with them, and, you know, being here for a lot of the little things, birthdays and, you know, graduations and stuff that I didn't necessarily come to. So I really love it here, but I'm not, I need to go home.
Mm-hmm.
And I hate winter. I don't say I hate many things, but winter is one of them. I am Floridized. I have thin blood, and I like to wear shorts in November.
So, Chrissy, looking back on this experience, in what ways can you say that you have become the heroine in your own journey?
When I saw that you said that, I chuckled. I know, because I don't. I understand what you're saying, but I hear the word or read the word heroine, I'm like, yeah, I don't know so much about that. It's, you know, a lot of people have referred to me and said, it's a miracle. You're a miracle. And that's very nice, you know, but at the same time, I'm like, nah, I don't know what you're talking about. Because that makes me feel odd. It makes me feel disabled, that people are no longer, and there's not that there's anything wrong with being disabled. I am disabled, but mm-hmm. I want people to say, oh, you know, Chrissy Ogilvie, she does amazing things for kids with autism. Not, mm-hmm. oh, Chrissy Ogilvie, she, you know, lost her life. She couldn't go to the bathroom on her own for four mm-hmm. months. Even longer than that. I don't want to be known as that. So when people say, you know, you're a miracle or that, it makes me weird. I don't actually know how to answer that question.
That's okay. That's all right. It might not be the right time in your life to do that. I mean, you know, we were talking before, Bree and I, about how, you know, when people come back from a war experience and it's really traumatic, that they don't see themselves as heroes, but other people do see themselves, see those people as heroes, because, you know, even though you don't want to be known for this particular time in your life, you want to be known for the great things you do as an amazing teacher. You're still inspiring. And I'm going to tell you that right now. So
I have to second that, you know,
thank you.
I think it's amazing what you've put your mind to doing, and just, you know, look where you were to where you are. And you've done that.
Yeah.
You made this
pat on the back.
Yeah. I think that it's an amazing achievement that you have gone through this journey, and you're still going forward, and you have amazing aspirations to be back out there involved in the mm-hmm. autism community and being of service and teaching.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Because, I mean, I don't think that every single person would aspire that. They may have stayed in the place of giving up, you know? And so I see you as a heroine.
Agreed. Well, Chrissy, I just want to say, you know, thank you so much for taking the time to join us today and share your story. And it's just been such an honor to meet you and hear about this journey that you've been on. It's been incredible. And it's, you know, I'm awed at what you've been able to accomplish. I think it's really speaks to your determination and your courage, because I can imagine what it was like to lose everything and not have any answers. And sometimes you must feel like you're crazy when doctors can't tell you what's going on, but you know, something's not right. You know, but you've persevered, and you kept your spirit even in those darkest of times, and you're still going forward. And I wish you all the best of luck. And I just hope you get back to Pensacola soon and are able to manifest all the wonderful things you want for yourself.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, I second that. I mean, just so happy that you chose to share this with us on our podcast. And I said it to you before our recording, but your story is going to inspire many others. Who may have all, you know, given up, may have stayed in that place of giving up. And when people overcome great challenges with heroic measures, it gives credence to the saying, nothing is impossible.
Thank you so much for, I'm so glad that I was here. It's funny the things that you recall when you're doing one of these and you're talking and you're like, oh yeah, I forgot that happened. But thank you very much for your kind words too. You know, I just, you know, I hope that this will help someone there from feeling less alone than they were, just to have that connection. It as warped as that is, you know, I'm very glad to meet you. I'm so glad you're going through the same thing that I am, you know, you know, it's warped when you think about it, but at the same time, it makes it not so lonely.
That's right. It gives it meaning to what you've gone through.
Well, in the community, I think, you know, we're community animals, really. People like we crave community, want community, and what you've been through is so isolating,
right,
in so many ways, you know, and so it's not that you're wishing that upon anyone. It's just being able to connect with someone who's experiencing the same thing, someone who commiserate and inspire each other, right? Like that, build that community makes so much sense to want that.
And I understand you. I went through something similar, but it wasn't exactly the same. But a lot of the things you said, I totally resonated with. And I was, you know, having my own reflections of what happened with me. So this has been, you know, just amazing. And I'm so glad to see that you're getting back on the horse, so to speak, again.
Yes, you've been a huge support to me too, just in reaching out and just there before everything even happened. It's just, so it's really, I'm very, very thankful for that as well. And it's, you know, not that I'm glad that you went through what you did.
Yeah, you know, sorry, I get it.
But it's nice to have that clarity.
Yeah.
Chrissy Ogilvie has given us permission to share her contact information with anyone who would genuinely like to connect with her about her story. If you'd like to connect with Chrissy, please reach out to us through the contact page on shamansafterdark.com and we will be happy to get you in touch with her. Well, thank you again, Chrissy. And we hope that you will all join us next week as we talk about moving through fear. Until next time, everyone, keep on shining your light.